The road to launch for Monster Hunter Wilds was filled with warning signs, each one confirming that the game would be a technical disaster. First, the system requirements outright recommended frame generation just to reach 60 FPS. Then came the latest beta and benchmark tool, both of which showcased poor performance. And given the RE engine's track record with large-scale games, we had reasons to be concerned, and we all know what happened last time with Dragon's Dogma 2. But at least that game was mainly CPU heavy, while still delivering visuals on par with most current gen titles. And to be fair, I am not denying that Monster Hunter Wilds has some impressive visual aspects, mainly the character models and of course the monsters, which are the highlight of this game. However, on every other aspect, the game falls flat, and as a complete package, these visuals are what I'd expect from an early PS4 title. And despite its lackluster graphics, the game performs terribly. And unlike Dragon's Dogma 2, which was primarily CPU heavy, Monster Hunter Wilds is demanding on both the CPU and GPU, making its performance even harder to justify. Here, even with the lowest possible settings and balanced DLSS at 1440p, maintaining 60 FPS is not feasible on the 3060 Ti and the 5700X3D. Clearly, this must be some next gen level of rendering technology that our feeble hardware just can't comprehend. Or maybe, just maybe, it's a prime example of development laziness, failure to learn from past mistakes, and the very definition of poor optimization. So I don't recommend buying this game now, instead wait for more updates and patches. But if you still want to play it despite all these issues, I'll share with you some tweaks and recommendations that should slightly improve your experience. So let's get started with image quality. As you can see, the game generally looks washed out, and the main reason behind this is its poor color grading and brightness levels. So the first thing I recommend is going into the brightness setting and adjusting the game's black and white levels along with the overall luminosity. I can't give you exact values since it depends on your monitor and personal preference, but tweaking these should help alleviate the issue. And if that's not enough, I recommend trying reshade with some presets to enhance the colors and improve the overall look of the game. Just keep in mind that using reshade may come at a performance cost. The other aspect of image quality is upscaling, which of course is an absolute necessity to run these groundbreaking visuals. And here I found that the implementation of DLSS is not great, and in motion DLSS looks worse and exhibits more noise compared to FSR3 and XeSS. However, overriding DLSS transformer model with preset K using the Nvidia app results in a much better image quality and clarity. Thankfully, now we can fully appreciate these gorgeous visuals in all their glory. But as expected, this transformer model comes at a performance cost. Here on the 3060 Ti, it costs around 6%. But despite this, I highly recommend trying DLSS 4, as it should allow you to use lower upscaling tiers like balanced mode, which offers similar performance to DLSS 3 quality mode but with a much sharper and cleaner image. Another broken implementation is Nvidia's Reflex Low Latency, which when enabled on any mode leads to small spikes in the frame time graph, as you can see here with the 3060 Ti. Though this issue might not be 100% related to Nvidia's Reflex, because here with the 4070 Super, similar frame time spikes appear whether Reflex is enabled or not. However, in a more demanding area like here in the forest, similar to the 3060 Ti, enabling Reflex disrupts frame time stability. So if you are noticing these spikes, disabling Reflex might help stabilize the frame times. And now we arrive at Capcom's idea of the ultimate optimization button, frame generation. Let's first start with FSR3 frame generation, which to be fair works pretty well, and I did not encounter any major issues while testing it. And at least with the 50 to 60fps based performance and not the 30fps that Capcom recommends, the input lag felt fine. though I don't consider myself particularly sensitive to input latency, so your mileage may vary. But of course, this is Monster Hunter Wilds, so there is a catch. Despite the game supporting the latest FSR 3.1.3, they don't allow FSR 3 frame generation to work with other upscalers like DLSS. To get around this, you will need to use mods like Nukem's frame generation, specifically the version DLL, which is the one that worked on my system. Additionally, if you are using any mod or reshade, you'll need to download RE framework and copy the input 8 DLL to the game's folder. This bypasses Capcom's anti-tamper and prevents crashes. Thank you, Capcom. And now, as you can see, we can finally enable frame generation with DLSS on the 3060 Ti. However, Nukem's frame generation does not work as well as FSR 3 frame generation and exhibits unstable frame times. And it's all thanks to the broken NVIDIA Reflex, which is forced when using this mod or the official DLSS frame generation. But if you don't have any issues with NVIDIA Reflex and you want to use frame generation, consider using Nukem's mod or DLSS frame generation to take advantage of DLSS 4 transformer upscaling. Lastly, let's talk about the graphics settings. As with previous RE Engine games, the graphics menu here is well designed, providing preview images and indicating which component is most affected by each setting. However, there is some weirdness going on here, because changing the presets, as you can see here, also changes the upscaling mode, which is something I don't think I've ever seen in another game. But at least they forgot to enable their beloved frame generation when selecting the lowest presets. Maybe I should stop giving them ideas. When it comes to performance differences between the lowest and ultra presets, the gap isn't that big. I measured around 17% between the two presets on multiple scenes. This makes optimization through settings adjustments less effective for major performance gains. However, that does not mean you should just drop everything to the lowest or max everything out. There are key settings worth paying attention to, like the star of the show, texture quality, which when set to high on an 8GB by GPU even at 1440p with balanced DLSS leads to stuttering and higher RAM usage. So yes, if you have an 8GB GPU, you're stuck with these PS2 level textures. There is also a 70GB high resolution texture pack DLC, which does slightly improve the quality and clarity of some textures as you can see here, but using it on the 12GB 4070 Super results in severe stuttering and performance issues. So this is everything I have to say about the game, and honestly I am quite disappointed. Even though I've joked about the visuals throughout this video, that doesn't mean the game itself is bad. Beneath all these technical issues, there is a great and addictive game. But the only way to enjoy it is either with a high-end PC that can brute force through the problems, or by using frame generation while ignoring the added input lag, lackluster textures, and overall underwhelming visuals. And as I said at the beginning of the video, I can't recommend buying this game in its current state, because supporting poorly optimized releases like this only encourages developers and publishers to keep pushing out half-baked PC ports. So unless you are okay with that, vote with your wallet.